Hello world, it's Siraj, and by the end of this video, you will understand the basic math behind neural networks, since we'll build four types of them. You know that feeling you get when you're in love and you see that special someone? That magical, ethereal sensation that just can't be described by words? Well, it actually can be described by math. The features of a face, word associations, the tone of their voice, these are all related variables, and we can represent this relationship using a function. We have different models for approximating different functions, but humans can approximate almost any function. So wouldn't it make sense to model our own capability? Neural networks inspired by the brain are universal function approximators. That means they can learn any function. Although silicon is a very different medium than the chemical soup in our head, they're still able to replicate much of what we do like nothing else we've ever created. This was proven in 1989. We show that arbitrary decision regions can be arbitrarily well approximated by continuous feed-forward neural networks with only a single internal hidden layer and any continuous sigmoidal nonlinearity. Wait, what? Are you trying to throw hands here? Okay, if you wanna. Look, let's just build a simple AF neural network. All right, so given some input data X and some associated output labels Y, there exists a function that represents the mapping between them. Our goal is to learn that function so we can then input some random X value and it will predict its associated Y value. This input data is represented as a matrix where each row is a different data point and each column is one of its features. Just arbitrary ones and zeros in our case. So how do we learn this mapping? Imagine there existed a matrix such that every time we multiplied our input data by that matrix, the result would give us the correct output every time. That'd be pretty awesome, right? That's what we're trying to do. Find that matrix, that coefficient of the function we're trying to learn. We'll call it our weight value. So we'll initialize it as a matrix of random values. Eventually, we want this matrix to have the ideal values, values such that when we compute the dot product between our input data and this matrix, it will give us the correct output. But wait, we've got to add something else here. It's not enough to just say the product of these two matrices is our output. No, we'll need to pass that output into a sigmoid function to normalize or adjust the result to probability values between 0 and 1. So multiplying our input by this matrix and passing the result to this activation function gives us an output value. Four guesses, one for each data point. But the guesses are wrong. We know what our actual output should be. So let's compute the difference between our prediction and the actual Y values. We're pretty far off. We know that gradient descent works well for linear regression, so let's try it here too. We'll compute the partial derivative of the error with respect to our weight, and that gives us a gradient value. Gradient descent is all about finding the minimum of an error function, so let's adjust the values in our matrix by adding our gradient value to it. Now our predicted output is slightly better. And we just do this over and over again. Our error will decrease every iteration or time step, and eventually our network will be able to predict the right label. A neural network is really just one big composite function. That means it's a function that consists of other functions. Each layer is just a function that takes as its input the result of the previous function's output. That's it. The dataset we used had a linear relationship. There was a direct one-to-one relationship between the input and output values. But what if we use a dataset that instead had a one-to-one relationship between a combination of inputs, a non-linear relationship? Our simple AF neural network wouldn't be able to learn it. In order to first combine the input data into a representation that can then have a one-to-one relationship with the output, we need to add another layer. Our first layer will combine the inputs, and our second layer will then map them to the output using the output of the first layer as its input. So we'll multiply the input by the first weight matrix, activate it with our sigmoid, and pass the result to the next layer as its input. It just does the exact same process. Input times weight, activate. It rhymes. When we compute our prediction value, since we have multiple weight values to update, we'll recursively compute our error gradient for each layer we have in the opposite direction. Then we can update each weight value individually. That's why when gradient descent is applied to neural networks specifically, it's called back propagation. Because after we forward propagate our input data, we backward propagate our error gradient to update our weight values. What we just built was called a feed-forward network. They're great for modeling relationships between any set of input variables and one or more output variables. But what if time mattered in the input sequence? By that I mean, what if the ordering mattered? Like if we're trying to predict the next stock price or musical note in a sequence. Well, we'll need to modify our feed-forward network to become a recurrent network, which will allow it to learn a sequential mapping.
We could apply a linear transformation to the matrix.
Totally, I'm all about the projections.
That attitude will definitely help us with our convolutional network.
You have quite the work ethic.
Thank my single dad. He taught me that life isn't fair and that you have to work hard for your dreams.
Sounds like my kind of guy.
Yeah, you will definitely get along.
So this time we've got sequential input data. We still initialize our weights randomly like before, we still multiply our input by our weight matrix and apply an activation function to the result for every layer. The difference in forward propagation this time, though, is that for each element in the sequence, we don't just use it alone as the input, we use the hidden state from the previous time step as well. So a hidden state at a given time step is a function of the input at that same time step modified by a weight matrix added to the hidden state of the previous time step, multiplied by its own hidden state to hidden state matrix. Backpropagation in this case works the same way as in a feed-forward network. We calculate the gradients of our error with respect to the weights and use them to update the weights. But because recurrent nets are a temporal model, we call it backpropagation through time. Doc, let's backpropagate through time. But can a neural network still learn a function if we have unlabeled data? You betcha. And one neural net that can do this is called a self-organizing map. It works pretty differently, so let's look at it. We still start off by initializing the weights of the network randomly. Think of it as a two-dimensional array of neurons. Each neuron has a specific position topologically and contains a vector of weights of the same dimensions as the input vectors. The lines connecting nodes just represent adjacency. They don't signify a connection as normally indicated when talking about the previous networks. Then we'll pick a data point from our training set to calculate the Euclidean distance between that vector and each weight. The one that's closest to it is the most similar. It's the best matching unit. We iterate through all the other nodes to determine whether or not they are within the radius of it, then adjust the weights of its neighbors This whole process is what we repeat iteratively and is a part of the training procedure. This map of nodes self-organizes into clusters for each learned label. Nearby locations in the map represent inputs with similar properties. We can even visualize it, and this acts as a great tool to observe these clusters. And when we give these networks more, aka deeper layers, lots of data and lots of compute, we call that field deep learning. It's the hottest subset of machine learning. Although they are not a cure-all solution, they perform really well if you have those two things. To summarize, neural networks are just a series of matrix operations. No matter the type, they're just one big composite function. Because they use nonlinearities in this series of operations, like the sigmoid, they can approximate any function, both linear and nonlinear. And if we don't have labels for our data, we can use a type of neural network called a self-organizing map to learn the label clusters. The wizard of the week is Hammad Sheikh. I was so impressed by his notebook. It illustrated how using L2 regularization reduces overfitting for high degree polynomials in the context of linear regression, specifically the relationship between movie sales and movie ratings. You make me smile. And the runner-up is Ong Ja Ri. He used a regularized linear regression to predict the impact of climate change on temperatures in LA. What a dope use case. This week's coding challenge is to build your own self-organizing map. See the description for all the details and post your GitHub link in the comments section. Please subscribe for more programming videos. And for now, I've got to practice my Dutch. So, thanks for watching.